Welcome back to the big story of the Bible. My name's Sarah. So far we've seen that God made a good world and he made people very good in his image. He called them to rule and reign with him. But he gave them a choice to rule and reign with him and the freedom to choose not to. And what did they do? People chose to define right and wrong for themselves and to go the way they thought was good again and again and again and again through the beginning of the story of the Bible. We see that happening. And then God launches his rescue plan to bring the snake crusher through who? Through Abraham and Sarah. God makes a special promise to Abraham. What is that kind of special promise called? It's called a covenant. And what three ways does God promise to bless Abraham and his family? He promises to make Abraham's family into a great nation, to give them their own land, and to be a blessing to the whole world. We've already seen God fulfill the first part of his promise. Abraham had Isaac, who had Jacob and Esau, and Jacob had 12 sons that ended up down in Egypt. And after hundreds of years, they had grown into a whole nation of people. And last week, we saw God begin to fulfill the second part of the promise.
The first half of the book of Exodus tells the story of ancient Israel being rescued from slavery. And when people say the Exodus story, those are the chapters they're referring to.
But the book has a second half, where Moses gives the Ten Commandments to Israel along with these instructions about building a sacred tent.
And what links these two halves together is this crucial story. The people of Israel, they're out in the middle of nowhere. They find themselves at the foot of this mountain called Sinai. And here, God's presence comes dramatically down in the form of a violent storm cloud.
Now let's stop a second and talk about this concept of God's presence, because it's really important for the rest of the book. At the beginning of the Bible, in the Garden of Eden, humanity was in God's presence. They had this close relationship with him and it was good. But humanity rebels and the relationship is fractured and access to God's presence is lost. But God promised Abraham that he would restore his blessing to all of the nations, and that includes this restoration of relationship and access to God's presence.
So here at Sinai, God's presence is now right here in front of them, and it's actually quite frightening. And he's here to invite Israel into this unique and close relationship with him.
And the word used to describe this relationship is covenant. It's like a legal agreement between God and Israel. And it's unique because up till now, God hasn't asked Israel to do anything in return, just to trust him. But here on this mountain, God is going to ask Israel to do something. A lot of things, actually. He gives them a whole set of laws. It includes the Ten Commandments. And if they obey these commandments, they will become the people who will represent God to the nations of the world.
Like a priest would.
Yeah, in fact, that's what God calls them to become, a kingdom of priests. And this is all connected back to the promise to Abraham that his family would become a blessing to the nations.
God has brought them out of Egypt, and he's going to give them their own land and make them a blessing to the nations that surround them. And so he makes another covenant with all the people. He promises to be their God, and they promise to be his people and obey what he tells them, the laws and instructions that he gives them. This moment on and near the Mount Sinai is kind of like a wedding ceremony. God and the people promise something to each other. And before we go any further, we've got to see something really important. What happened first? God rescuing his special people, or them promising and trying to obey all the laws? First, God rescues them from Egypt. Before they know much about him, before they make any promises to him, before he gives them all the laws, first he saves them. Then he calls them to obey him. And this is still what God does. First, Jesus saves people, bringing them through the water from death to life, from slavery to sin to eternal life in him. And then he teaches them to obey everything. You don't have to obey all the rules for Jesus to save you. In fact, you have no hope of living anywhere close to what he teaches until you put your trust in him. All the Israelite people had to do was trust that God would save them, paint the blood of the lamb on their door, and follow him through the sea. And all you have to do is trust the blood of the true and better sacrifice, Jesus, on the cross. And when you're ready, when you can trust him for yourself, and not only because of what your parents have taught you, you can choose to be baptized and come through the waters to eternal life.
Woo-hoo!
What's the difference? What difference does it make to how you think and feel and act to know that Jesus saves you first and then he teaches you to obey him, rather than thinking that he saves you when you obey him well enough? Parents, share with your kids first about how that affects you, and then maybe they can share with you as well. So God saves his people, and then he teaches them and gives them instructions and laws so that they can become a nation, that they can live in their new land and be a blessing to all the nations around them.
Okay, but obeying these laws is going to be difficult because there's a lot of them and they set a really high standard.
Though if you think about it, I mean, of anybody in the world who should be able to do it, I mean, it's these people who experienced firsthand God's grace and his power when he rescued them from slavery.
And they agree to obey the terms, but then they refuse to go into God's presence because it's still a bit frightening.
And since the people won't go up, Moses goes up to the mountain by himself to meet with God. But God still wants to be with all of his people. And so he says, okay, if the people won't come up here to me, I'll come down off this mountain to be with you all. And that's why he orders Moses to build this elaborate tent as a place where God's presence can be among his people.
And that's why the next thing we get is 7 chapters of extremely detailed architectural blueprints for this tent. It's really, really, really long.
But every detail is important and has some kind of symbolic value. For example, there's all this Garden of Eden imagery inside the tent. And it's to remind you that when you're in the tent, you are in God's presence.
Does anyone know what this special tent is called? It's called the Tabernacle. The tabernacle was a special place of God's presence on earth. That sounds like something like the garden was. The garden was an overlapping of God's living space, heaven, and our living space, earth. God wants to be with his people. So he gives Moses and Israel the instructions to build the tabernacle, and he brings his presence down to them like he did in the garden.
So, if you lived in ancient Israel, one of the most important places was the tabernacle.
The tabernacle was a sacred tent that the Israelites carried as they journeyed to the promised land.
And it was sacred because it's where the heavenly presence of Israel's God lived on earth. And the tabernacle had an important design to show just how special it was. There's the outer courtyard, then an entry room into the tent, and it leads into the center of the tabernacle, the Holy of Holies, God's personal throne room, and it's guarded by these heavenly hybrid creatures called cherubim. Notice, the closer that you get to the center, the more sacred the space becomes.
But there's a problem. Just like Adam and Eve couldn't be in God's special presence anymore because of their sin, neither could Israel. Even though they promised in the covenant to obey God. Does anyone know what the first thing they did right after they made that promise was while Moses was up on the mountain getting all the instructions from God? Right away, they broke the first commandments. They made an idol, a golden calf, and a pretend version of God, and they worshiped it Right after they promised to only worship God and to not make any idols. How were they ever going to be able to enter the tabernacle to be back in God's presence?
Now remember, the story of the Bible began with humans in God's presence, but they were banished because of their rebellion. However, God wants to be in relationship with us, so he chooses one family that he will use to restore the world back into his presence.
And so God's presence comes to dwell in a tent right in the middle of Israel.
And that's great.
But it creates a problem because it's so intense that Moses can't go in, and other priests who enter inappropriately, they die.
Well, wait, if God's presence is good, how is it all of a sudden dangerous for people?
So think of it this way. God's presence is like the sun. It's pure power and goodness. And when something mortal and corruptible gets close to such pure power, it's destroyed. And so the word holiness is used in Leviticus to describe God's pure and powerful presence, which, like the sun, is both good and dangerous.
We see this kind of thing happen so many places in the Bible. For example, when Moses saw God at the burning bush. Or in this story, when Moses is up on the mountain and wants to see God's face, Moses says, "Show me your glory." And the Lord said, "I will cause all my goodness to pass in front of you, and I will proclaim my name, the Lord, in your presence. I will have mercy on whom I have mercy and compassion on whom I will have compassion." But he said, "You cannot see my face, for no one can see me and live." Then the Lord said, "There's a place near me where you may stand on a rock. And when my glory passes by, I will put you in the cleft of the rock and cover you with my hand until I have passed by. Then I will remove my hand and you will see my back, but my face you must not see." No one can see God's face and live because we have a problem.
We all long for the world to be good, for people to live in peace, act with love and justice. But there's a problem. Something compels us humans to constantly wreak havoc and destruction instead, and we call this evil.
And from the Bible's point of view, evil ruins things in at least two ways. There's a direct effect of our evil, like when someone steals from another person, they've created injustice.
Yeah, therefore, you know, they owe something to make it right.
But there's another indirect effect of evil, because they've also ruined the environment of the relationship, creating a lack of trust, there's emotional damage. It's like vandalism, and they need to make that right, too.
Now, many people believe, hey, God is good. He should be the one to just get rid of all the evil in the world.
But let's be honest. I mean, the evil that I see everywhere out there, it's the same evil that's inside of me. We have all contributed, and we keep doing it.
And so this kind of puts us in a bind. If God's going to rid the world of evil, he'll have to get rid of us.
Do you ever wish that God would get rid of just all the bad things in the world, all the evil? Sometimes I wish that. What about you? Doesn't that sound great? It would be great, but I know that I'm part of making the evil and the badness in the world. And I can try really, really hard all I want, but I keep doing and thinking bad things that hurt other people. And I know you do too. So if God's gonna get rid of all the evil, how's he gonna do that without getting rid of me and you? Before I talk more about the ultimate answer to that question, we'll see how the temple and the animal sacrifices were part of that solution.
And this is what's so remarkable about the story of the Bible. This God is so good that not only is he going to rid the world of evil, he's going to do it without destroying humanity.
So how is he going to do that?
Well, early in the story of the Bible, we're introduced to this practice of animal sacrifice, which I know, it seems weird to us, but for the Israelites, it was a very powerful symbol of God's justice and of his grace. So remember, I'm a contributor to the evil that's in the world. I should be removed. But God is allowing this animal's life to be a substitute. It's symbolically dying in my place. And the biblical word for this is atonement, which means to cover over someone's debt.
Let's all say that big word, atonement. Okay, I'm sure you didn't actually say it, so let's all actually say it. Atonement means to cover for someone. Like, For example, if you went to Avondale, like a convenience store, with your friend, and you chose a chocolate bar, and maybe you're so excited to eat it that while you were going up to the cashier to pay for it, you opened it and took a first bite. And when you reached in your pocket to pay for it, you realize you forgot your money at home and you'd already opened it. What are you gonna do? And your friend reaches out and says, "I'll cover you," and hands the cashier money to pay for you. That's atonement, when someone covers for you. Have you ever done something bad or made a mistake or a mess and someone else covered for you? Someone else cleaned it up. Someone else dealt with the bad consequences. Parents, you can share first, and then your kids can share as well. So God gives the Israelites many, many, many laws. Some, like the Ten Commandments, which we talked more about in last year's big story of the Bible, are moral laws, telling the people what and how to do good, how to love one another. Some are civil laws about how to function as a country and society, because remember, they didn't have any government or any police or like anything. They just were slaves in Egypt and then came out and now have to be their own country. And many are ritual purity laws, laws about how they're supposed to come into God's presence, the sacrifices they're supposed to make at different times and for different reasons, and many other details. Right in the center of the book of Leviticus, which Hebrew style of writing, when you put it in the center, that means it's like the key thing, are instructions for a special holiday. Last week, we talked about a special holiday that the Jewish people celebrated every year. What was it called, and what did it help them remember? It was called Passover, and it helped them remember that death passed over their house and did not kill their firstborn son when they painted the blood of the spotless lamb on their door. The lamb covered over or atoned for the life of their firstborn. Passover reminded the people of how God brought them out of Egypt. What most important thing happened 1600-ish years later on Passover that Christians still celebrate today? And why was it meaningful that it happened on Passover? Jesus died on a Friday during the celebration of Passover. Jesus was the real Passover lamb that allowed God's judgment to pass over us. And we'll end today by learning about another Jewish holiday, the one at the center of the book of Leviticus.
And it's here that we find a really important ritual called the Day of Atonement.
Yeah, so Israel's a big tribe now, and odds are there's a lot of sin happening that goes unnoticed, that people are not dealing with. And so one time a year, the priests would take two goats, and one of those goats is killed, and its blood is carried right into God's presence where it symbolically covers or atones for Israel's sin.
Yeah, that's kind of weird.
Well, the meaning of the sacrifice, it's explained in the next chapter, where God says that the blood of a creature is its life. And so this goat's life is offered as a substitute. It's receiving God's punishment for Israel's sin so that the people don't have to.
That leaves the second goat.
Yeah, the priest puts his hands on it, and then he confesses all the sins of Israel. It's like he's placing the sins on the goat. And then that goat gets cast out forever into the wilderness. It's called the scapegoat.
Yeah, I've heard that word before.
Yeah, it's this very powerful image of how God is graciously removing Israel's sin.
On this Day of Atonement, once a year, one man of all the people, after all the sacrifices, would be able to go into the Holy of Holies, the hottest hot spot of God's presence. One person, once a year, would get to come into that holy place, into the presence of God. Jesus is the true Passover lamb and the true Day of Atonement goat, the perfect sacrifice that dies in our place. And we also know that Jesus is like the second goat, the scapegoat. All the sins of all the people were put on the goat, and then it had to go away, had to leave the presence of God, like Adam and Eve, like Cain. When Jesus was on the cross, he says in Matthew 27, "My God, Why have you forsaken me? On the cross, Jesus was outside of the presence of the Father. He became like the scapegoat. All my evil and selfishness was on him, and yours too. And so he, like the scapegoat, was away from the presence of God. 2 Corinthians 5 says, Christ didn't have any sin, but God made him become sin for us, so we may be right with God because of what Christ has done for us. And guess what happened the moment Jesus died? After Jesus cried out in a loud voice, he died. And at that moment, the temple curtain was torn in two from top to bottom. The curtain that separated the Holy of Holies, the place of God's presence available to one man once a year, was unleashed and available now for everyone. Jesus is the true and better Passover lamb and the true and better atonement goat and scapegoat. His sacrifice didn't deal with sin for one year, but for all time. His sacrifice was once for all the sacrifice that all the other sacrifices in the Bible point to. And that is the big story of the Bible. Take some time to pray as a family. Maybe you need to say sorry for some of the bad things you've done and ask for forgiveness. And then pray and ask God to remind you that all those sins have been taken totally away by Jesus' once and for all sacrifice. For today's craft in your package, you're going to find a few pieces of cardstock printed with parts of the tabernacle on them. They look like this. And what you're going to do is cut out each of those pieces. Parents, you might need to help if you have younger kids with this. Some of the cutting is a little technical. And you get to build a model of the tabernacle. And this will be a really great visual reminder of how we go in and in and in getting closer and closer to the hot spot of God's presence in the Holy of Holies. I hope you have fun building your model tabernacles, and maybe some of you can come up with cool ways of like upgrading them, you know, maybe using like purple cloth for the curtain in front of the Holy of Holies, or putting some, I don't know, I'm sure you guys are gonna get creative, it's gonna be awesome. But whatever you do, we want to see the pictures of your craft. So don't forget to include your pictures in the link below in the Google slide of all the pictures, and we are going to choose one as a winner. Speaking of winners, let's have a look at last week's awesome crafts. There is calming, there is song, there is teasing, there is war, there is loving, we are torn. And here is this week's winner. Great job. We are gonna send you, or have already sent you, depending on when you watch this video, an exciting prize to your doorstep. We will see you next week.